हेलो एवरीवन, इन टुडेज लेक्चर वी विल मूव टुवर्ड्स द नेक्स्ट पॉइंट्स इन द एयरपोर्ट इंजीनियरिंग, दैट इज व्हाट इज एयरक्राफ्ट, व्हाट आर द कंपोनेंट्स ऑफ द एयरक्राफ्ट एंड द कैरेक्टरिस्टिक्स ऑफ द एयरक्राफ्ट. सो व्हाट इज एयरक्राफ्ट? इट इज नथिंग बट इट इज अ मशीन विच फाइंड सपोर्ट इन द एटमोसफियर ड्यू टू द रिएक्शंस ऑफ द एयर इज डिफाइंड एंड एज द एयरक्राफ्ट. एयरक्राफ्ट इज नथिंग बट द मशीन विच can be in the air due to the reaction of the air. Okay, it can be heavier or lighter than the air and may be power or non-power driven. So this aircraft may be heavier than the air or lighter than the air, and it may be either power driven or non-power driven. So what are the examples of aircrafts? The example of aircraft is either the airships or the balloons. The airships are lighter than air and they are power driven, whereas these balloons are higher than the air, lighter than the air and non power driven. So aircraft and balloons are an example of airships and balloons are the examples of the aircrafts with a lighter weight than air, and they are power driven and non power driven. So airships are the ones which are power driven and balloons are the lighter ones which are non power driven. So aeroplanes and helicopters are the heavier than air and also the power driven. So if we have to distinguish this aircrafts into lighter than air and power driven, then the example is the airships. And if the aircraft is to be lighter than air and non-power driven, then balloon is an example. Whereas if aircraft is heavier than the air and is also power driven, then the examples are aeroplanes and helicopters. Okay. So we will move towards the component parts of an aeroplane. So various parts, essential parts are as of the aeroplane are as follows. First is the engine, second one is the propeller, third one is the fuselage, fourth the wings, fifth is the three control system, sixth one is the flaps, and seven is the tricycle undercarriage. So now one by one we will see in the descriptive. One by one we will see the component parts of an aeroplane in descriptive manners. So this is the image showing the various components of aircrafts. So we have seen the first one was the engine, second one was the propeller, this is the propeller, third one was the fuselage, this is the fuselage, then fourth one was the wings, these are the wings, fifth one was the three control system, this is the three control system, then flaps, these are the flaps which are attached to the wings, then the tricycle undercarriage. So these are the various components of aircraft which can be seen in the figure. The propeller, the fuselage, the gear system, the wings, the ailerons, then flaps, these are the stabilizer, horizontal stabilizer, vertical stabilizer, this is the elevator and this is the rudder. Okay, so we will first see what is engine. We know the main purpose of an engine is to provide a force for propelling. Okay, that is for moving from forward and backward movement. Okay, so the main purpose of the aircraft engine is to provide a force for the propelling the aircraft through the air. For the movement of the aircraft in the air, engine helps. Okay. Now this can be classified according to their propulsion. Okay, so piston engine can be there, jet engine can be there, rocket engine can be there. So there are three types of engine which can be used for propelling the aircraft through the air, that is piston, jet and rocket one. So there are some speed limits based on this type of engines. So we will see the propulsion limits. the engine and the speed limits in kilometer per hour. For piston, the speed limit is 250 to 750 kmph kilometer per hour. For ramjet, it is 1280 to 2400 kilometers per hour, and for rocket it is high, that is 4600 kilometers per hour. So now we will see what is the propeller. We have seen in this image, these are the wings at the trailing edge of the aeroplane, okay, or it is the aircraft, it may be aeroplane or a helicopter. Okay, so propeller is provided in the conventional piston engines aircrafts as well as in the turbo-propelling engines. So these propellers are provided for piston type engine and turbo type engines. Okay, it usually has two or more blades which are driven around in a circular path. So here there are two blades which can move in a circular path. So this blades deflects the air backwards with an acceleration, and thus forward thrust is imparted to the aeroplane. Okay, these blades move in a circular path, due to which the blade deflects the air towards backside, and thus forward thrust is imparted to the aeroplanes. So when these propellers are in front, it is called as the tractor type. So in this image, the propellers are front, so this is a tractor type. And when the engine and the propeller are kept behind, it is called as pusher installation. So there are two types of propellers, the tractor type one and the pusher type. So when these propellers are at the front, they are called as tractor, and when the propeller as well as the engines are kept behind, they are called as pusher ones. So clear about propellers. Now we will move towards the fuselage. So fuselage is nothing but the main body of the aircraft. It forms the main body of the aircraft. So the fuselage includes what it includes. It includes the cabin or a cockpit which contains the seats for the occupants, the controls for the airplane. Okay, in addition to this, the fuselage may also provide a room for the cargo, an attachment point for the other major airplane components. So fuselage is nothing but the main body of the aircraft. It may include the cabins, which is occupied by the seats for the occupants. Then it may have controls for the airplanes. Then it may have some room for the cargos and various attachment points for the airplane components. So some aircrafts utilize an open truss structure. So some aircraft has open truss structures. The truss type fuselage is constructed of steel or the aluminium tubing. So now we will move towards the next component, that is three controls. Mainly there are three axes, x-axis, y-axis and z-axis. Similarly, in case of aircrafts, these three axes are the ones about which the aircraft in space moves. Okay, this axis and the possible aircraft movements can be seen in this figure. See, this is the x-axis, this is the y-axis and this is the z-axis. So when the aircraft moves about the x-axis, the movement is called as lateral movement or the rolling movement. Okay, similarly, when the aircraft moves about the y and z axis, they are called as pitching and yawing movements. Okay, pitching and yawing movements. Okay, depending upon the movement of the aircraft about the various axes, the movements are classified. So lateral one is the lateral movement, is the movement of the aircraft about the x-axis, whereas the pitching one or the yawing one are the movements about y and z-axis. So to control these movements of the aircraft, they are provided with three principal controls: the elevators, the rudders, and the aileron. Okay, so we can see these are the elevators, these are the rudders, and the aileron. So now we will see the three principal components, its functions. Okay, so elevator, first elevator. See, in this figure we can see the blue portion is called as elevator. This is the principal controls for controlling the movement of the aircraft about the axis. So it consists of the two flaps which are capable of moving up and down through an angle of 50 to 60 degrees. So elevator, this elevator has an ability to move up and down, okay, through an angle of 50 to 60 degrees. They are hinged to a fixed horizontal surface which is called as the tail plane or a stabilizer. So this elevator is hinged with the horizontal stabilizer, which is also called as the tail plane. You can see in this figure, this is the elevator which is hinged with this horizontal stabilizers, which are placed at the extreme rear of the fuselage. So this is the trailing edge and this is the rear edge. Okay, so what this elevator does, it controls the pitching or up and down movement of the aircraft. The function of this elevator is to control the up and down movement of the aircraft. Then the second one was the rudder. Okay, second one was the rudder. So we can see in this image, this part is called as the red portion is called as the rudder. So it consists of a streamlined flap. This is the streamlined flap which is hinged to the vertical stabilizer or a vertical fin which is provided at the tail end, which is called as vertilizer stabilizer. So it can move right or left of a vertical axis, means this rudder can move towards left or towards right through an angle of about 30 degrees with this vertical axis. Okay, so what does this rudder does? It is utilized for the turning or yawing movement of the aircraft. Okay, we have seen the movement of the aircraft about the Y and Z axis is called as the yawing movement. So it is utilized for the turning movement of the aircraft. Now we will see what is ailerons. So this green part in the wings is called as ailerons. So ailerons is a hinged flap. It is hinged flap which is fixed in the trailing edge of the wing near to the wing tips. So this is the wing tips. These are hinged to the wing tips. It is so rigged that when the aileron in one wing is pulled up, then in other it is pulled down. So you can see in this image, this part is raised up and this part is raised down. So when one side is pulled up, the other side is pulled down. So there is tilting of the wings. So the net effect gives a very powerful rolling control to the aircraft, and this is to balance the plane when tilted by a gust of wind. Okay, so due to this effect, it helps the aircraft to balance when tilted by the gust of wind. Okay, so it also permits to tilt the machine, like while describing a circle. So while taking a turn, it also helps the machine to tilt. Now we will see what are the flaps. These are somewhat similar to the ailerons. Okay, they are somewhat similar to this ailerons. See, these are the pink ones are called as the flaps. Okay, so see, this is the image which is showing these are the ailerons and these are the flaps. So they are similar to the ailerons and they are used in the landing and takeoff. These flaps are used during the landing and takeoff of the aircraft. Okay. When they are projected into the air, they produce immediate reduction in the speed of the aircraft and thus serve as the air brakers. So they act as the air brakers. They reduce the speed of the aircraft. Okay, so they act, the flaps acts as air brakers. Okay, now we will see the tricycle undercarriage. So tricycle undercarriage is nothing but the landing gear system which is help to support the aircraft while it is in the contact with the ground. So it has two principal functions. The first one is the suitable assembly of wheels allows the aircraft to move onto the runway carrying its entire weight. If the wheel arrangement assembly is suitable, it helps to carry the entire weight and allows the aircraft to move onto the runway. The second main principal function is the aircraft during the landing touches the ground. We know that the aircraft during landing touches the ground with certain velocity. This undercarriage system permits to occur it smoothly. So for the smooth landing of the aircraft, this undercarriage system plays a major role. Okay. So tricycle undercarriage is nothing but the landing gear system which supports the aircraft and permits the landing of the aircraft smoothly. Okay. Now we will see the various aircraft characteristics. So following are the characteristics which needs to be studied. Okay, so first one is the type of propulsion. Second one is the size of the aircraft. Third one is the minimum turning radius. Fourth one is the minimum circling radius. Fifth one is speed of the aircraft. Then sixth one is the capacity of the aircraft. Seventh one is the aircraft weight and the wheel configuration. Eighth one is the jet blast. Ninth one is the fuel spillage. 10th one is the noise. 11th is the range. 12th is the takeoff and landing distance. And 13th one is the tire pressure and the contact area. Type of propulsion. The size of aircraft, its circular radius, the speed characteristics and the weight carrying capacities and many other parameters depends upon the type of propulsion of the aircraft. Okay, the general parameters or general characteristics of the aircraft, such as size of aircraft, the circling radius, the speed, the weight carrying capacity, all the parameters mainly depend upon this type of characteristics, that is the type of propulsion the aircraft uses. So the performance characteristics of aircraft, which determine the basic runway length, also depends upon the type of propulsion. Okay. Also, the basic runway length is also decided depending upon the type of propulsion. So, that heat nuisance due to exhaust gases is a characteristics of the turbojet and the turboprops engines. Okay. So, the type of propulsion is the main characteristics of this aircraft, depending upon which the size of the aircraft, the circling radius, the other speed characteristics, the weight carrying capacity of the aircraft, the basic runway length of the airport is decided. Okay. So this is the basic main characteristics of the aircraft. The second is the size of the aircraft. So, the size of the aircraft involves the following important dimensions. So, what is included in the size of the aircraft? First is the wingspan. How much wingspan should be there? the fuselage length, the height, the distance between the main gear, that is gear train, and the wheel base, the tail width. So this all dimensions are involved in this size of the aircraft. So the wingspan decides the width of the taxiway. So wingspan is mainly helps in deciding what the width of the taxiway should be. It also helps to separation clearance between two parallel traffic ways. It also decides the size of the apron and the hangars and the width of the hangar gate, etc. So the width span decides various parameters, that is width of taxiway, separation clearance between two parallel traffic ways, and any other parameters. So the length of this aircraft decides the widening of the taxiways on curves, the width of the exit taxiway, the size of aprons and hangars, etc. So as wing space decides some parameters, length of aircraft also decides some parameters. So length of aircraft decides the widening of taxiways on the curve areas, the width of the exit taxiway, and the size of apron. Similar to this, the height of aircraft, okay, also called as empennage air height, decides the height of the hangar gate. What hangar gate must have the height and the miscellaneous installations inside the hangar. Okay, and lastly, the gear train and the wheel base affects the minimum turning radius of the aircraft. So the wheel base, this gear train and the wheel base, these are the dimensions which affects the minimum turning radius of the aircraft. So the size of aircraft involves various important dimensions, and this dimension decides the different parameters. Okay. So this is the second type of characteristics, that is size of aircraft. Okay, now what is mean by this hangar? Hangar is nothing but a large garage like structure where the aircrafts are used. So the length of aircraft, the height of aircraft decides the sizes of these hangars. Okay. So hangar is nothing but the garage where the aircrafts are kept. Clear about the second characteristics, that is the size of aircraft. Then we will move towards the third characteristics of aircraft, that is minimum turning radius. Now, in order to decide the radius of this taxiway, the position of aircraft in loading aprons and hangars, and to establish the path of the movement of the aircraft, it is very necessary to study the geometry of the turning movement of these aircrafts. Okay. In order to decide the radius of the taxiway and the position of the aircrafts, either in the loading aprons or in the hangars, or to establish a path or to decide a path for the movement of the aircraft, this study of the geometry, that is the turning movement of aircraft, is very important. Okay, the turning radius of an aircraft is illustrated in this figure. Okay, this is the path of main gear, this is the path of the nose gear, this is the angle of turning of nose gear, and this is the turning radius. This turning radius helps in deciding the radius of the taxiways, the position of the aircrafts either in the loading aprons or the hangars, and also helps in establishment of the path over which the aircraft will move. So, to determine the minimum turning radius, a line is drawn through the axis of the nose gear when it is at its maximum angle of rotation. So, to determine this maximum turning radius, a line is drawn from the axis of the nose gear when it is at its maximum angle of rotation. When this angle is at maximum, a line is drawn through the axis of the nose. The point where this line intersects another line drawn through the axis of the two main gears is called as the center of rotation. So the intersection of this point C, this point is called as the center of the rotation. Now we will move towards the next characteristics, that is minimum circling radius. For an aircraft to take a turn in any area, there must be a certain minimum radius. So this radius is nothing but the circling radius. This radius depends upon the type of aircraft, air traffic volume and the weather conditions. So this radius mainly depends upon three components, that is the type of aircraft, the air traffic volume present in that area and the weather conditions in the area. So the radii recommended for the different types of aircrafts are as follows. So depending upon the type of aircraft, the radius, that is circling radius, is as follows. For small general aviation aircrafts under UFR conditions, the circling radius is 1.6 km, that is 1 mile. And in case of bigger aircrafts, say for the two piston engine under VFR conditions, the minimum circling radius must be 3.2 km, that is 2 miles. For the piston engine aircrafts under IFR conditions, it must be 13 kilometers. And for the jet engine aircrafts, it must be 80 kilometers. So these are the recommendations of the circling radius for various types of aircrafts. So the two nearby airports should be separated from each other by an adequate distance so that the aircraft simultaneously landing on them do not interfere with each other. We know this, that the two airports which are located near to each other should be separated by an adequate distance. The distance between them must be adequate so that it will allow the easy landing of the aircraft without any interference. If the desirable spacing between these two aircrafts cannot be provided, the landing and takeoff aircrafts in each airport will have to be timed so as to avoid the collision. And in case, if at a particular location, if this is not possible, that is to maintain the distance between two airports is not possible, then the takeoff and landing of the aircrafts in each airport can be handled by the time, so as to allow the collision of the aircraft with each other. Okay, now we will move towards the next characteristics, that is the speed of the aircraft. So the speed of the aircraft can be defined in two ways, the ground speed and the air speed. Okay, the speed of the aircraft may be defined in two ways, because on the ground the speed will be different while landing and while taking off, and in the air the speed of the aircraft will be different. So there are two different definitions of the speed of the aircraft. The air speed is the speed of the aircraft which is relative to the wind. The air speed of the aircraft is the speed which is taken when the aircraft is in air. Thus, if the aircraft is at a speed of 500 kilometers and there is a headwind of 50 kilometers, air speed will be 450 kilometers per hour. Okay, so speed of the aircraft will be 450 kilometers per hour in relative to the wind. Now we will move towards the next characteristic, that is aircraft capacity. So what is aircraft capacity? The ability of the aircraft to accommodate the number of passengers, packages, cargoes and fuel is the nothing but the aircraft capacity. So this aircraft capacity depends upon the capacity of aircraft. Okay, the capacity of aircraft using an airport have an important effect on the capacity of the runway systems. We have seen, depending upon the capacity or the size of the aircraft, whether it is number of aircrafts are more than the runway systems are, number of runway systems are provided. Okay, so the capacity of the aircrafts using an airport having an important effect on the capacity of the runway systems as well as that of the passengers processing terminal facilities. So this is the description of the characteristics, that is aircraft capacity. Now we will move towards the other characteristics of aircraft, that is weight of the aircraft and the wheel configuration. So the weight of the aircraft directly influences the length of the runway as well as the structural requirement. Okay, weight of the aircraft has its influence on the length of the runway and the structural requirements of the airport. That is, it is directly proportional to the length of the runway and the structural requirements, that is nothing but thickness of runways, the taxiway, the aprons, the hangars. Okay, so these are directly proportional to the weight of the aircraft. It depends not only on the weight of the passenger baggage, cargoes and fuel it is carrying and its structural weight, but also on the fuel which is continuously decreasing during the course of the flight. So weight of the aircraft is also dependent upon the fuel which is continuously decreasing during the course of the flight. Okay, now we will see what is maximum gross takeoff weight. The maximum load which the aircraft is certified to carry during its takeoff is nothing but the maximum gross takeoff weight. The weight which is allowed, the maximum load which is allowed while taking off is nothing but the maximum gross takeoff weight. Then what is maximum structural landing weight? The difference between the gross takeoff weight and the weight of fuel consumed during the trip is nothing but the maximum structural landing weight. Then what is operating empty weight? Operating empty weight is nothing but the weight of the aircraft including the crew and all the necessary gear which is required for the flight. Okay, now what is payload? It is total revenue producing load, means whatever the load present in the aircraft which is producing revenue is nothing but payload. And also it includes the weight of the passengers and their baggage, cargoes, etc. Now what is zero fuel weight? It is the weight above which all the additional weight must be fuel. So these are the type of weights: maximum gross takeoff weight, maximum structural landing weight, operating empty weight, payload and zero fuel weight. Okay, now we will see what is jet blast. At relatively high velocities, the aircraft ejects hot exhaust gases. Okay, the velocity of the jet blast may be as high as 300 km per hour. When the aircraft is moving at the higher velocities, this ejects hot exhaust gases. The maximum velocity may be up to 300 km per hour. This high velocity causes inconvenience to the passengers while traveling in the aircraft. Several types of blast fences or jet blast deflectors are available to serve as an effective measure for the diverting the smoke ejected by the engine to avoid the inconvenience to the passengers. So, in order to avoid this ejection of the hot gases and to prevent the inconvenience caused to the passengers, several measures are taken, that is blast furnace or jet blast deflectors are used. Since the bituminous flexible pavements are affected by the jet burst, therefore it's desirable to provide a cement concrete pavement at least at the touchdown portion to resist the effect of the blast in the preference to the bituminous pavements. So while the jet blast, it is preferable to have the cement concrete pavements. The effect of the jet blast should also be considered for determining the position, size and location of the jets. Also, the effect of the jet blast should also be considered for determining the position, size and location of the jets. Now, the next characteristics is the noise. The most serious problem facing the aviation is the noise. The most basic problem is nothing but the noise. The major sources are the machinery noise during the landing and the primary jet during the takeoff of the aircraft. So, the major sources are during the landing and during the takeoff. The disturbance caused during the takeoff is more severe as compared to that of landing. So, we will see the next characteristics, that is takeoff and landing distance. This takeoff and landing distance helps in determining the minimum runway length which is required for a particular type of aircraft. So, the takeoff and landing distance helps in the deciding the minimum runway length for a particular type of aircraft. It depends upon the various factors such as altitude of the airport, gradient of the runway, the intensity and the direction of the wind, the weight of the aircraft at the time of landing and takeoff. This takeoff and landing distance depends upon these factors, that is altitude of airport, gradient of the runway, intensity and direction of the wind, weight of the aircraft at the time of landing and takeoff. Okay.